If you have your Bibles with you today, please open them to the Old Testament book of Isaiah. If you don't have a Bible with you, don't panic. We're going to have the verses up on the screens for you, so you can follow along with that today. For those of you that have the handheld devices, I'm preaching from the New International Version, so you can sync up with us on that. Also, most of you should have gotten one of these in your bulletin. And if you didn't get one, I think Ray's going to come forward and hand them out. Is there anybody that does not have one of these? Raise your hands for me if you would. Okay, we got Ray. Ray, we have several of them around here. Keep your hands up for me, please. I'm excited to have the opportunity to preach today. I learn a lot when I prepare for a message, and I get so thrilled about it, and I love to share it with people. Today we're going to talk about blind spots. I'll give you just a second here as we hand out the handout. Today we are going to talk about blind spots and how our blind spots can keep us from seeing God for who He really is. Let me begin by sharing a cute story with you. Sherlock Holmes and Watson were on a camping trip and had had plenty of liquid refreshment and had gone soundly to sleep on this bright, starry night. In the middle of the night, Holmes awakened, looked up at the night sky, dug his elbow into Watson's side and said, "Watson, Watson, wake up. What do you see?" Watson looked up and said, "Stars and stars and more stars." Sherlock Holmes asked, "What does that tell you, Watson?" Watson responded, "Well, astronomically, it tells me that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. Astrologically, it tells me that Saturn is in Leo. Aurologically, it tells me that it's about 2:45 in the morning. Meteorologically, it tells me that tomorrow will probably be a beautiful day. Theologically, it tells me we're just a tiny part of the great whole. Why, Holmes, what does it tell you?" "Watson, you idiot, someone has stolen our tent." Dr. Watson had a blind spot which caused him to overlook the obvious. Someone had stolen their tent. Now, let's begin by defining what a blind spot is. What I mean by that, just so we're all on the same page. A blind spot is anything that keeps us from seeing things as they truly are. Again, anything that keeps us from seeing things as they truly are. I came up with three different types. There may be more than that, but three will do for us today. The first type of blind spot we're going to talk about is the total blind spot. This is where we don't see what's there at all. And the best example I came up with for that was anybody who's taken driver's ed and learned how to drive a car or a truck, we've all been warned about the blind spots on the sides of the vehicle. And that if we rely just on our rearview mirrors to see what's back there, it could be very dangerous. Because an entire car or truck can be hidden back there, and unless we turn our head to look at it, we won't see it out of just using our side view mirror. So that's an example of a total blind spot. The second type of blind spot I came up with is a partial blind spot. And this is where we see what's there, but not as it truly is. And the example I have for that, about 3, 4, 5 months ago, I got a new pair of glasses. They're wider. They're a little broader than what I was used to. And if I just glance out of the edge of one of the lenses a little bit, I get a distorted picture. I see what's there, but not as it really is. Where this really comes into play is when I'm walking by our full-length mirror in our bedroom, and I take a little glance out of this corner here, I lose about 20 pounds. And at a glance, that's really pretty attractive. But then when I turn my head just a little bit and the whole picture comes into focus, then reality sets in. So, by the way, if you're starting to think that it might be a good idea for your self-esteem to get a pair of wider glasses, it makes my head look really strange shaped. I get a funny shape, so it's a trade-off, so I wouldn't recommend that. There is the blind spot, the third one that's created by the familiar or by repetition. We assume that because this is what we're used to and we've always done it this way, it must be okay. Now, before I go any further, I need to make a confession to you, the congregation. I have been disobedient. God impressed upon me to preach this message back in the fall of 2016. And I've been putting it off because this is a difficult and sensitive topic today. If I'm not very clear and careful, I may step on some toes, and that is not my intention. But I feel strongly that God wants this sermon preached today. I don't say this lightly, but God showed me what I can only call a vision back in the fall of 2016. And I will be sharing that vision with you later on in this message. Now, I want to give you a quiz. But don't get all tense. Don't get all excited. It's just a one-question quiz. And nobody's going to know your answer but you. Because I'm going to ask you not to say anything out loud. I just want you to think about this question. I want you to form your answer in your mind. And I want you to hang on to it because we're going to come back to it later on in the sermon. Here is the question. How would you respond and react if Jesus showed up here physically this morning? What would be your response to being in his presence? Would you sing? Would you shout hallelujah? Would you clap your hands? Would you jump up and down? Would you run up to him and hug him? What would you do? Now hang on to that. We're going to come back to that. May I suggest that perhaps each of us has somewhat of at least a partial blind spot when it comes to God. When we think we know who he is and we think we understand his character, but do our actions suggest otherwise? What I want us to do today is to look at a Bible character who had an encounter with God and see how he responded to being in God's presence. I think we can learn a lot about ourselves and our understanding of God by comparing how we think we would react to how this character actually reacted after coming face to face with God. And if you stay with me, everyone here can leave here today with a better understanding of who God is, what he is like, and how we should approach him. And before we get into the ministry, to the message, rather, let's ask for his blessing upon this time. Father, we thank you that you have provided a place for us to gather. We thank you that you have brought us here today. We thank you, Lord, that you have provided your word and you have protected it and preserved it over the centuries so that we can still access it today, that we can get into it and we can learn about you. And we can learn about our expectations, or your expectations, excuse me, for us. Bless this time, Lord. Open up these verses to our mind, to our heart, and to our very spirit. Help us to see what's here today, Lord. Speak to us in the way we need to be spoken to. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think you're in Isaiah. We're going to turn to chapter 6. We're going to look at the first 8 verses of Isaiah chapter 6. Now, this is an exciting passage, and we'll see the picture that Isaiah paints of his vision of God in his heavenly throne room. My prayer is that we will leave here today with a, using the language of today, a high def or a high definition understanding of God's holiness. Follow along with me if you would. Isaiah 6, beginning at verse 1. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, here am I, send me. Okay, let's flesh this out just a little bit to see if we can't understand all that's being presented in this passage. Here in the sixth chapter, we see Isaiah's call or his commission to be a prophet, a spokesman for God. And go back to verse 1 with me, if you would. We're just going to take this little section by little section at a time. Verse 1 at the beginning, it says, in the year King Uzziah died. Now, you can pronounce it Uzziah, you can pronounce it Uzziah. Either one is correct. But the year he died was in the year 740 B.C. Now, that's a long time ago. According to my math, it's 2,758 years ago. But I hope everybody understands that the Old Testament is just as relevant and pertinent to our lives today than it was to those who originally received it. Now, this is a very traumatic time. This is a time of national crisis for the southern kingdom of Judah. Uzziah became king at age 16, and he reigned from 792 B.C. to 740 B.C., some 52 years. That's a very long reign for a king. There were very few good kings during the time of the divided kingdom. Between the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, out of 39 total kings, only 8 of them would be what we would consider a good king. And Uzziah was one of those. Uzziah was a good king, a godly and powerful king, and it was a time of unusual peace, advancement, wealth, and prosperity in Judah. Uzziah was a good king, but not perfect. His 52-year reign ended tragically when he chose to burn incense in the temple, which could only be done by a priest. God struck him with leprosy, and he later died. So that sets the scene for a little bit for the time that Isaiah is recording this. The kingdom of Judah is reeling. There was widespread fear and uncertainty when Uzziah died. The future looked grim. In fact, history shows us that this was the beginning of the downfall of Judah. It's as if the people of Judah were saying, what hope do we have if even our good king Uzziah failed? And here in this passage, Isaiah shows them their real hope. Continuing on in verse 1, it says, I saw, stop there. Most Old Testament scholars believe that Isaiah's vision of God's heavenly temple, this is a vision of God's heavenly temple. It may have taken place. Isaiah may have been in the earthly temple. But the vision he is seeing is a vision of God's heavenly temple. He goes on to say, the Lord, stop there. Look how that word Lord is spelled. It's capital L, small O, small R, small D. And what this signifies, that spelling of that word, it signifies the Hebrew word Adonai. It's a title. It's a title for God. Adonai, it means the sovereign one. So the one who is vested with absolute authority. The sovereign God of heaven and earth who raises up kings and brings kings down. He was absolutely sovereign. Even though Uzziah failed, the sovereign king of the universe is still on his throne and he will never fail. By the way, the Apostle John tells us in his gospel in 12:41 that this sovereign king of the universe that Isaiah sees on the throne is actually Jesus Christ himself. Isaiah goes on, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Now what on earth, actually what in heaven, does that mean? That's not something we talk about on a regular basis. But if you dig into this, and this is why it's so important to kind of break things down and get behind it and understand it. One of the ways a king's greatness was measured was by the length of the train of his robe. Now, I think everybody knows what I mean by the train of his robe. King wears a robe, but at the back of it, extending out behind him, is what's called the train. Much like many of the bridal gowns we see today, they have this train on them. One of the ways a king's greatness was measured was by the length of the train of his robe. The greater the king, the longer the train. And you can see in this picture, his train filled heaven. It filled the throne room. There was no extra room. God can't be any greater than what he is. He is the absolute greatest. There's no more getting any greater than what God is. In verse 2, it says, above him were seraphim. Some translations say seraphs. We're not going to get into a lot of detail about that. Just understand it's a type of angel, has six wings. Not all angels have six wings. The seraphim do. This is the only place in the Bible where they're mentioned, by the way, showing them in heaven, in God's throne room, praising God. And they were calling, verse 3 says, and they were calling to one another. This appears to be done antiphonally. Now, we don't know how many there were. There's at least two, and there may have been many, many. We just don't know. But it appears that some were on one side of God and some were on the other side of God, and one would call, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. And that would be answered by the other side. Holy, holy, holy is the God Almighty. And back and forth in an antiphonal way. Okay, we need to stop and take some time to look at the word holy. If we're really going to understand what this passage is teaching, and if we're really going to grasp what the Bible says about God's holiness, we need to take some time. It's important we do that to look at this. I'm hoping we leave here with a greater understanding and appreciation for its meaning, and we see that it's not just a word in a song, but that it carries tremendous importance in seeing who God really is. And please follow along either up on the screen or in your handout here. As I read this, I want you to follow along. I want you to get the understandings, there's two of them, of the word holy. The first one I'm going to read, actually both of them are a quote from Dr. Stephen Lawson, where he says, quote, the primary meaning of holy is that God is separated above his creation. The word holy means to separate, to cut something in two so that the two sides are now distant and removed. The holiness of God means God is set apart from his creation, that he is separated above his creation. We are not on his level. God is elevated above us. He is distinct from us. He is superior to us. He is a cut above us. He is holy other than us. He is high and lifted up. God is exalted in glory, far above us, supreme in his greatness. There is the idea of royalty, regalness, dignity, splendor, dazzling in his kingly glory. This is what it means for God to be holy, unquote. And this refers to the high and exalted or lifted up that we read in verse 1. Now, for a secondary meaning, I'm continuing to quote from Dr. Lawson. Quote, the secondary meaning of holy is God's moral perfection, his moral excellencies. He is sinless. He is without moral blemish. He is flawless in all of his ways. All of his decisions are perfect. All of his judgments are perfect. All of his decrees are holy and perfect. Everything about this great God is holy and perfect. Unquote. Now what I'd like you to do is to try and keep in mind both of those definitions of the word holy as we see how the text uses that word. I'm in verse 3 again. We read, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Now stop right there. If you were sitting in front of your laptop or your desktop computer at home or even writing on a pad of paper, what techniques do we have? And I'm looking for some answers from you. What techniques do we have if we wanted to stress a word or a phrase or bring attention to something? What might we do? Oop, I heard underline. Bold, highlight, repetition, capital, exclamation points, italicized. There we go. You're doing very well. You did very well. Those are all techniques that we have, again, if we want to bring importance to something. In the Hebrew language, back to my spot here, one technique the Hebrew language uses for emphasis is to use a word twice in a row, to repeat it. And you will remember that this went on into the New Testament times. How many times when Jesus was talking did he say, truly, truly, I say unto you? Or in the King James, verily, verily, I say unto you. What he's doing is he's using this technique. He's saying the word twice, and he's saying, sit up and take notice, because what I'm about to say is super important. And not to mislead you here, every word that is recorded in Scripture that Jesus said is super important. But there were times when he wanted to bring a special emphasis on something he was about to say. And that's the way he would do it. He would use the word twice to kind of key us in. Here, the word holy is used how many times? Three times. That's incredible. And actually, I have the number three here bolded and underlined in my notes because I want us to understand fully the importance of using that word three times in a row. It's called a superlative usage. To raise something to the superlative degree is to use it three times. God is not just holy. God is not just holy, holy. God is holy, holy, holy. In the entire Bible, God's holiness is his only attribute to be stressed to this degree, to the ultimate degree, the nth degree. Although God is love, the Bible never says he's love, love, love. Nor does it say he is truth, 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 or mercy, mercy, mercy. His holiness is his only attribute to be treated this way. Are you starting to get a sense of Isaiah's comprehension of what he is seeing in this vision of God in his heavenly throne? Take a close look at the word Lord here. I think we're still in verse 3. Look at it real closely. How does this word Lord differ from Lord in verse 1? All capitals. Here we go. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That's not a typo. That's an intentional thing done by the editors because they wanted to note that the Lord in verse 1 is a different word than the Lord here in verse 3. And what this is, this capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, this is the word Yahweh. This is God's personal name, the sacred name of God. Some of you may have heard the term tetragrammaton. That's what this refers to. Not only is the one we see seated on the throne the sovereign king of the universe, Adonai, from verse 1, he's also Jesus, as John told us, and it's God himself, Yahweh, all in one. This is who is seated on this throne. And we learn from the seraphim, the whole earth is full of his glory. Now, as the angels are proclaiming the holiness of God, verse 4 tells us that even inanimate objects, the doorposts and thresholds of the temple, respond to this declaration of God's holiness and his glory by shaking. Even the physical environments are responding. Environs, rather, are responding to his holiness. And verse 4 also says, and the temple was filled with smoke. This is reminiscent of other Old Testament appearances of God where he was accompanied by smoke, as at Mount Sinai. While we're here in this passage here, while we're here in this picture, I want you to notice something. There is no casual worship in heaven. There is no casual worship in heaven. Now, I really want us to focus in on Isaiah's response to coming face to face with the living God. Here in verse 5, he says, Isaiah says, woe to me, I cried. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips. Literally, I am disintegrating because I have a dirty mouth. Isaiah pronounces woe upon himself and declares he is ruined. Again, I think in the King James, it's undone. He is falling apart. He's disintegrating. He was coming apart at the seams. Quoting from Dr. R.C. Sproul, quote, he was experiencing psychological, theological, and spiritual disintegration, unquote. Now why? He tells us why. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Isaiah knows that, like the rest of us, he is a sinful man. If you would have polled the people of Isaiah's day, and asked who knew Isaiah, and asked them who is the most righteous person they knew, and who had the greatest integrity, they would have said Isaiah. So why is Isaiah undone and falling apart? What's the big deal? Because Isaiah says in verse 5, "My eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Isaiah has seen God in His perfect holiness. Isaiah wasn't measuring himself against other people, but against God. It doesn't matter how we stack up against other people. The only thing that matters is how we stack up against God's perfect holiness. Isaiah's sin, even though he probably was a quote-unquote good man, is blatantly obvious compared to God's complete purity and holiness. Quoting from Dr. Sproul again, and this is important, please hear this. Quote, "For the first time in his life, Isaiah really understood who God was. And the immediate reaction and consequence of that was that for the first time in his life, Isaiah knew who Isaiah was. One glimpse of the unveiled holiness of God, and he disintegrated." Unquote. There's not any kind of blind spot here for Isaiah. It's crystal clear and painfully obvious how he stacks up against a holy God. And the word that kept coming into me as I was working on this, I don't even know if it's a word, but cringe-worthy was what kept coming into me. It's like Isaiah sees himself and he sees God and he just cringes when he's comparing himself to the holiness of God. And he can't help it. He just is cringing. God showed me this the other day. Many of you that know me, you know I work in a new car dealership. And management does all it can to make the cars on the showroom just look as pretty and as polished and as shiny as possible. And they clean them up and they polish them and we try to dust them and we just put them under the lights and make them look just as nice as they can because people tend to buy the car if it looks really nice. I hope I'm not giving out a trade secret here, but that's what they do. They keep them looking very, very nice. We look at that car and it looks so nice and perfect. Our dealership faces the east and big glass windows in the front. And this happened the other day and it just fit perfectly with this. The sun in the morning shines in through those windows. And when the sun shines directly on those cars, you can see every speck of dust. Every speck of dust. You may have run into this at home. You clean off a counter or a bookshelf or an end table and you think it's clean, it looks good. But boy, sun comes through that window and it's just showing every little speck of dust. God's pure holiness and His brilliant glory shines an intense spotlight on each and every one of our sins. There are no sins hidden from God. Now, based on the picture of God and His holiness that we see recorded here in Isaiah's vision, what should our attitude be? And how should we respond to God as we approach Him in our worship or even as individuals? Should it be a casual affair? Should it be a buddy-buddy kind of approach? Based on what we have seen, that doesn't appear to be appropriate. Quoting from Dr. Lawson again, quote, "The church has always been strongest when it has had its highest regard for the holiness of God. And those times when the church has been weakest has been those times when it has lost the sense of the vertical holiness of God and want to bring God down to our level, and everything is on a horizontal type relationship with God. That is when the church has been the weakest, if not even unregenerate." Unquote. Now, someone might say, but Isaiah lived in the Old Testament times. We live in the New Testament church age, after Jesus has appeared and paid the penalty for our sins by dying on the cross, and then conquering death and the grave by coming back to life and ascending into heaven, where He sits at the right hand of God the Father. And if we repent, which means to turn away from our sins, and respond to God's drawing us to Himself, then as true believers in Jesus' work and ministry, our sins are forgiven. Every word in that paragraph is true. Every word is true. But let me ask a question, and I'm looking for an audible response here. Does God ever change, No. God never changes. The big word is immutable. It's one of his attributes. And that's exactly what it means. God never changes. Malachi chapter 3, the first part of verse 6, it says, I, the Lord, do not change. In Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ, who is God, is the same yesterday and today and forever. If God never changes, what has changed over the years? Maybe it's us and the way we approach him. Maybe there's a blind spot there caused by the familiar and the gradual, almost undetectable changes we've made over the years. For those who have been believers for quite a while and are old enough to remember, it wasn't that long ago, maybe 15 years, maybe 20 years ago, when reverence and honor were a given during a worship service. We were taught it at a young age, and it was just part of the fabric of being in church. It appears that in our effort to make the church experience more attractive and palatable for the unbelieving world, we have sacrificed having a proper approach to God. I don't think we should be lowering the bar. Maybe our role as the church is to demonstrate to the world and to pass along to younger generations and newer believers where the bar should be set when approaching our holy God. Is God any less holy or any less deserving of excellence and worship than he was in Isaiah's day? No. Even in today's day and age, God still deserves honor, reverence, and respect. I had an experience here on a Sunday morning in the fall of 2016, unlike any I've ever had. For a long time leading up to that morning, I had been contemplating the casualness of our worship service and as an elder, wondering if it should be something we addressed. I was standing in the back of the sanctuary, waiting for the designated time to make an announcement, encouraging those who were planning on attending the pastor's appreciation dinner to be sure to sign up so we would have an accurate head count. All of a sudden, I became super sensitive to what was going on around me and up on the platform. I did not hear an audible voice, but I sensed God impressing upon me, my spirit rather, to take in what was happening and what we were offering to him in the name of worship. What I saw was greatly distressing and even distasteful. It seemed so disrespectful that I just wanted to leave. I went as far as to go out into the foyer to get the car keys from my wife. She was signing people up for the appreciation dinner as they entered the building. Then I remembered my announcement, so I reluctantly went back into the sanctuary, still distraught. Here are some of the things God had me observe that morning. There were only about 20 people present at the start of the worship. Several people continued to visit out in the coffee area after the service started. The overall feeling was more like a concert than a worship service. At one point, one of the singers, after singing his verse, passed the lead off to another singer by saying, "Take it, sister." Many people continued to arrive as much as 20 minutes late. One person was 40 minutes late. But I noticed that 2/3 of the latecomers had taken the time to stop at McDonald's or Tim Hortons to get their beverages. Two people had popcorn. Others had snacks, which prompted me to think, other than the teaching, how is this any different than a concert or a movie theater? Everything seemed very casual. Casual in approach, casual in dress. There were some hats. There were many distractions. I observed talking in the back. I observed talking in the back rows during the singing and in other parts of the service. Many people freely got up during the service, left, and came back. I learned later on that day that one of the deacons who was serving in some other area of the church, he wasn't in here, offered an unsolicited observation when he commented on how interesting it was that We can sit through a 2 to 2.5 movie, excuse me, two to two and a half hour movie in a theater without having to get up. But how many couldn't make it through a 1.5 hour worship service? As these things were being pointed out to me, it was as if our supremely holy God was asking, is this really the best view and these people have to offer me, the creator of the entire universe, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Are you giving me your best? Sadly, I would have to say we weren't. What would you have thought if you were God and we had offered up a half-hearted, sloppy attempt at worship? I don't point this out to come down on anybody or single anyone out. I believe it's a blind spot we all have, and it needs to be addressed. But what concerns me is that I'm afraid we don't even see the problem. Church, someone has stolen our tent. So how do we address this blind spot? What's the solution? This is where application comes into play. Are we going to respond to what God has shown us in this message today? I would like to propose this. Let's be intentional and God-focused with our worship service. Let's make absolutely sure that God has no doubt as to why we gather here. So what does being intentional and God-focused look like? Well, I came up with the 5 B's. It's not exceptionally clever. It's not exceptionally highbrow. It's just a way to kind of put some thoughts together that maybe we can kind of remember them. Be number one, be prepared. Come to church with a proper frame of mind, expecting to experience an encounter with God. Confess your sins before you come to church. We know that the Bible teaches that if we have unconfessed sin in our lives, there is a problem with the communication between us down here and God up there. It's cloudy and it's blocked. And until those sins get confessed, He's not going to hear our prayers and we're not going to hear from Him. So confess your sins before you come to church. This is a simple thing, but don't argue. Don't argue with your spouse. Don't argue with your kids. Don't argue with your neighbor if you have an encounter with your neighbor or someone else. That's not the proper frame of mind to come to church with either. I'm not offering this. I'm not saying this, that everybody should do this. I'm just sharing something that has fit me. On Sunday mornings before church, I don't turn on a computer. I don't turn on a TV. I don't turn on a radio. I personally don't want that outside experience. Unless I'm listening to Christian music or a Christian teaching. That I'll listen to. But I don't want that outside worldly influence affecting my thought process before I come here to worship God. Again, I'm not saying everybody has to do that. Might be something you try if you're not doing that. But it works for me. It helps me to stay focused. Okay. The second B, be on time. And for anybody who knows me, you know I've told you in the past that I struggle with this. This is an issue for me of being places on time. So I am not pointing any fingers. But let me just say this. Isn't it interesting that on many Sunday mornings, there are people out front of Debbie's Dollar waiting for them to unlock their doors, but we struggle to get here on time? Interesting. The third B, be God-focused. Let's give Him our full attention during the worship service. He is the main reason we gather. Focus on what is going on, whether we're singing as a congregation, whether we're praying, whether it's the sermon, whether it's during communion. Participate and focus on what's going on. Yes, part of Sunday morning is fellowshipping with one another, and that's a big part of gathering here. But let's not do it at God's expense. Let's visit all we want to before the service and after the service. But during the service, let's remember why and for whom we are here, and let's give Him the honor and respect He deserves. Now, B4, or the fourth B, this is be considerate. And what I mean by this, basically, in essence, is don't be a distraction to others. allow others to stay God-focused by not being a distraction. I almost hate to share this, but bless his heart, I had a good friend come up to me, I don't know, a year ago or whenever, several months ago. And we had started the service. We were singing the first song, one of my favorite ones, This is Amazing Grace. And I'm in the back row there by myself, and I'm singing away, and I'm participating. And he came up behind me during the song, put his hands on my shoulders, and asked, hey, how is Louise doing? Because he knew earlier in the week she was ill, and he didn't see her. Well, she was working in the nursery at the time. Bless his heart for inquiring about the well-being of my wife. But that's something that should have been done either before the service or after the service. Not during it, not as an interruption. If you happen to come late on a Sunday, maybe it's better to sit in the back. Probably less distracting than to come up to the front, sit near the front somewhere where everybody's eyes kind of catch you. So maybe better to sit in the back. If you have to use the bathroom, fine, use the bathroom, but perhaps better to use those doors over there than these over here. And the example I'm going to give you, I want you to raise your hands. How many of you noticed Gary when he got up and walked out of here? Raise your hands for him. Gary was a plant, okay? Thank you, Gary. If you can hear me, you can come back inside. Oh, he's back there. I did that intentionally because our eyes were wired that way. We follow motion. And when somebody is distracting, your thoughts weren't on me telling you to be considerate. You were looking at Gary and, well, why is he walking across the front and whatever. So you get the point, though, okay? You get the point. Lastly, the fifth B, be here. Be here. Attend regularly. Make it a priority. Don't allow the things of this world to regularly draw you away. And this is what Pastor Dave was hitting on last week. It may be your boat that draws you away. It may be your camper. It may be that you stay up too late the night before and you can't get up because you didn't get enough sleep. It may be golf clubs or other sports-related activities. You know better than anybody what it is that keeps you away. So be here. Very simply, be here. Now, I have to include this. This is what I am not saying, okay? Please do not misunderstand what I'm trying to say. What I am not saying is this. I am not saying that Jeff is perfect and has all the answers. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying we need to be legalistic in our approach to worship. I'm not saying you can't get up if you need to use the restroom. 5 years ago, I had surgery, and it was very much on my mind how close I was to a bathroom and how I could get there if I needed to. So I know there are times we have to use the restroom. Just use the doors in the back then. I'm not saying we shouldn't show emotion. If you think back, I have not mentioned emotion this morning. It has nothing to do with any kind of a distraction. Sunday morning should be perhaps our most emotional time of the week. Worship is breaks down into two things. Who God is and what he's done. And giving him thanks for what he's done. Who he is and Who he is and what are his attributes, the things we praise him for, and then what has he done, either for us personally or in putting the world together or whatever. That's what worship is all about. That should be the most emotional time of the week for us. We have so much to be thankful for, all that he's done. Debbie will agree with me. God is awesome. He is praiseworthy. There's emotion there. Now, we all demonstrate emotion in different ways. I'm not saying we all have to do it the same way, but I'm not saying that you shouldn't show emotion. This is a perfect time, Sunday mornings in worship, to show emotion. I'm not saying we have to wear suits and ties and dresses. And I'm not saying that we can't go on vacations. Everybody needs vacations now and then. I'm not saying any of those. So please don't go to Pastor Dave and says, Jeff said this or Jeff said that. I'm not saying any of those things. In closing, what should be our approach to worshiping this holy God we serve? Let's be intentional and give him our full attention and make him the focus of the service. Let's put him first and give it our best attempt to worship him in excellence. Isn't he worthy of our best? Sure he is. Sure he is. The Christian church lost a giant of the faith in December of 2017. Dr. R.C. Sproul, whom I've quoted a few times this morning, after 40-plus years of faithful teaching and preaching, the Word of God was called home to his eternal reward. Much of the emphasis of his ministry focused on trying to get people to understand the holiness of God. In a letter he was asked to write that would be mailed to the ministry partners after his death, he wrote the following. Quote, "My passion on earth was to awaken people to the holiness of God, and in heaven I now see that holiness face to face. But the need to awaken people to God's holiness did not end with my departure. From my present vantage point, the urgency of that mission is only magnified." Unquote. A colleague of his summed up his ministry in the following way. Quote, "R.C. taught us this. God is holy, and we are not. In between is the God-man Jesus Christ and his perfect work of obedience and his atoning death on the cross. That was the message and the legacy of R.C. Sproul." Unquote. And what a legacy it is. Okay. The second quiz I mentioned, we're going to come back to this. This is it again. No need to get excited again. It's one question. In fact, it's the same question I asked you before. But this is the after-teaching quiz, and I'm wondering if your response may be a little different. Here's the question. After looking in detail at Isaiah's vision of God on his heavenly throne, now, how do you think you would respond if Jesus showed up here physically today? I would like to think that we now realize we would most likely be flat on our faces before him. Now, even though God doesn't choose to show up here physically Sunday mornings, he is here spiritually. Shouldn't he still be treated with honor and reverence and respect? Please stand with me as we close in prayer. Our Heavenly Father and our God, we thank you for this brief glimpse into this passage in Isaiah. We thank you for the way this passage teaches us just how holy you are. Holy, holy, holy. Father, we would ask that in the same way that Isaiah's vision of you on your throne changed him for the rest of his life, that we may be changed today for the rest of our lives when it comes to understanding your holiness and your purity and just how high above us you are, and how we don't even begin to compare to what you are. Father, if we have treated you with disrespect in the past, if we have not been honoring, please forgive us, Lord. Please forgive us. And as we go forth from here today, Lord, may we not ever do that again. May we be focused on you and your greatness. You who are Adonai, the King of the entire universe. You who are Yahweh, God. You who are Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, who did, yes, come and die for our sins. We have so much to praise you for. We have so much to thank you for. We just, our entire beings, we owe to you. Our entire lives and everything in it, we owe to you. Father, never let us ever again take you for granted. May we be reminded constantly that you are holy and we are not. In the wonderful and glorious name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen.